Hello, Riles. For lesson 5.7, when we're solving compound trig equations, I want to take a look at two similar equations here, with just one little difference in their symbols that causes a huge difference in our approach. Right. We are solving from 0 to 2 pi to the nearest hundredth here. If necessary, we might, as always, if we recognize a ratio, we can get by without our calculator. Should get mine ready. Okay, so the big difference here, well, both of these equations have two different trig ratios in them, and that can sometimes cause a problem. The equation on the left, though, those two different trig ratios are in different factors. We have an equation that's in factored form. It's written as a product, and we want to know when is that product equal to zero. This presents an opportunity for us because instead of expanding or treating it like a, I guess it kind of looks quadratic in nature because there's multiple instances of theta, oh, and also an exponent of 2. The way we solve quadratics is by factoring, is splitting it up into two linear equations. So we split this up and we say either 2 times the secant of theta squared minus 3 is equal to 0, or the tangent of theta is equal to 0. And now the fact that we have two different trig ratios does not concern us at all because they are separated into two separate equations. I know when the tangent of theta is equal to 0 from 0 to 2 pi. If I use my XYR definition, that happens when y is equal to 0, which happens at 0, pi, and 2 pi. Then I can come over here and I can solve this equation. Why don't we rearrange to adding 3 to both sides, dividing both sides by 2, giving us the secant of theta squared equals 3 halves squared. Treating it as a quadratic, we want to think about the possibility of two solutions. So when I'm not going to try solving this one by factoring. I'm going to do this one by isolation. I get the square root of 3 halves plus or minus, sorry. And let's go to a primary ratio. The secant of theta is often the reciprocal of the cosine of theta. So why don't we just reciprocate both sides and say the cosine of theta is plus or minus the square root of 2/3. I'll take a curve sketch approach from here. From 0 to 2 pi, 2/3 is about 0.6. The square root of that, is going to be a little bit larger than 0.6. Keep in mind, square rooting numbers between 0 and 1 makes 0 bits bigger. Doesn't really matter what size we're talking about. It matters that we're talking about positive or negative numbers that are definitely between 1 and negative 1. And I'm seeing the same sort of double symmetry that we've discussed before, that related acute angle is going to give me 4 solutions, one in each quadrant that has that related acute angle there. So I'm ready for a theta 1, theta 2, theta 3, theta 4 here. Numbering things is going to be problematic because I don't want to lose track of these solutions either. But I guess I could like label theta 1 from here. So let's go to our calculator. It's in radian mode. We ask for, well, why don't we get 2/3 out of the way? And then take the square root of that, and then we can take the inverse cosine of that, and we get one solution of about 0.62. Right. Call that theta 1. I don't know what order we want to go in. Normally I would call this theta 2 because theta 2 is related to theta 1 through symmetry. Theta 2 then would be 2 pi minus 0.62. Theta 3 in this case is also related to symmetry. In other cases it might be a different equation. Theta 3 that's going to happen at pi is going to be pi minus 0.62, and theta 4, I guess I'd call it that one right there, is going to be about pi plus 0.62. Again, this double symmetry doesn't always happen when I have a quadratic trig equation, but in this case there's symmetry in my quadratic solutions and my quadratic roots, so there's symmetry in my trig roots. You can type these in yourself and check them. Notice then that we have like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 solutions from 0 to 2 pi. Okay. The other equation doesn't have as many solutions, but it is quite a bit trickier because of the fact that we have different ratios. This example is from the textbook, by the way, one of the examples that they gave, and they expect students to know a kind of obscure identity that you may have been taught in grade 11. It's a reciprocal Pythagorean identity. I'm going to avoid that because I haven't really advertised it and I don't expect students to have it memorized. So let's talk about our options here. We have different ratios. We usually try to solve these compound equations by writing factors at least with only one ratio. So let's see some options here. I guess I could start by using reciprocal and quotient trig identities by saying, well, I know that the secant of theta is the reciprocal of the cosine of theta squared, I guess, minus 3 plus the sine of theta over the cosine of theta. It's a traditional approach to try to get things in terms of sines and cosines, but this doesn't seem to have helped much because I still have sine and cosine ratios. My next attempt here would probably be to try to clear my denominators by multiplying both sides by the cosine of theta squared. I would probably go that far before sort of giving up on this approach or trying something else. That would give me 2 minus 3 times the cosine of theta squared plus the sine of theta times the cosine of theta is equal to 0. Let's just make sure we understand that removing a common factor here is not going to be beneficial because my left-hand side isn't in a factored form. Like I could write 2 equals 3 times the cosine of theta plus the sine of theta times the cosine of theta, and I haven't made any mistakes yet, I don't think, and then remove a factor of the cosine of theta. But this doesn't help. When is the cosine of theta times 3 plus the sine of theta equal to 2? It's my left-hand side isn't equal to 0, or here my left-hand side isn't in a factored form, so this just hasn't paid off. I think I lost an exponent there. Oops. Yeah, so it's even worse because there's still two different ratios in that factor right there. Other options, I mean, I could try using the Pythagorean identity to write this as 1 minus the sine of theta squared, but I'm still going to have a cosine of theta there. You shouldn't have to replace the cosine of theta with plus or minus the square root of 1 minus the sine of theta squared. Let's try something else. All the way from back here-ish. Let's see. If we had 2 times 1 divided by the cosine of theta squared minus 3 plus the tangent of theta equals 0. If we try to keep things in terms of tangents of thetas, then maybe we're not too upset with the introduction of a sine of theta, or specifically a sine of theta squared in here, because that would give me a quotient identity. So we want to be careful with the use of this identity, but sometimes replacing one with the Pythagorean identity in a reverse order yields benefits. Let's see what happens. If I do 1 is the sine of theta squared plus the cosine of theta squared all over the cosine of theta squared. See, like, I could write this as minus 1 minus 1 minus 1. I don't want to replace each one of those with a sine of theta squared plus a cosine of theta squared. That'd be silly. So I see three different trig ratios here, but I see an opportunity to write this division as two sums, as a distributed sum. Be very careful when you do that. The fraction bar creates its own parentheses. When I distribute across that fraction bar, I need to make sure that this 2 is going to be distributed. So why would I want to do this? Oops, that's minus 3 plus the tangent, goodness gracious, plus the tangent of theta. There we go. Perfect. I don't think I can keep the original on there, but here was the original. It had two different trig ratios. I'm manipulating the expression, and my goal is to try to find one trig ratio per factor, and this is in a standard form, so I really want to try to get one trig ratio. And I can see I'm within reach here because the cosine of theta squared divided by the cosine of theta squared will be a constant of 1. It'll eliminate the cosine of thetas. And here is a quotient identity. Okay. It is a tricky approach. A student might be rewarded, let's say, if they remembered that the secant of theta was 1 plus the tangent of theta squared. secant of theta squared is 1 plus the tangent of theta squared, but it's not honestly going to be that useful. Yeah, let's see what happens here. We get 2 times the tangent of theta squared plus 1 minus 3 plus the tangent of theta equals 0. I'll show you the approach that you can use to try to build this identity in a sec. But here we go. We have 2 times the tangent of theta squared plus 2 minus 3 plus the tangent. That's my problem, is when I see the plus, I start writing t. Plus, that's one of my problems. Plus the tangent of theta. And I can tell that I'm on track to get this in a quadratic form. So let's try 2 times the tangent of theta squared plus the tangent of theta. Minus 1 is equal to 0. I'll probably try factoring 2 and 1 and 1 and 1. 2 and 1 can get me to 1 if I do plus 2 minus 1. So let's do plus and minus. So we get 2 times the tangent of theta minus 1 multiplied by the tangent of theta plus 1. Let's check with distribution. 2 times the tangent of theta squared plus 2 tan theta minus 1 tan theta is 1 tan theta minus 1. Looks good. And now, I mean, I had one trig ratio. Now I have two separate linear equations, each with one trig ratio. No big deal. That means that 2 times the tangent of theta minus 1 is equal to 0, or the tangent of theta is minus plus 1 is equal to 0. This gives me the tangent of theta equals 1 half. This gives me the tangent of theta equals negative 1. I might think that I recognize this ratio, but that's from equilateral construction, and there's no ratio of y to familiar ratio of y to x, where the ratio is 1 to 2. If we're in standard position here, because I generally don't use tangent curves to help me solve, we're talking about x being 2 and y being 1, or x being negative 2 and y being negative 1. Right there and there. Or this one we recognize, that is 3 pi by 4. Or 5 pi by 4. With the points negative 1, comma 1, or 1, comma negative 1. Right. So here I'll go to the calculator. What is the inverse tangent of 1 half? Calculator tells me. We'll call it theta 1 is about 0.46. That means that theta 2 is going to be pi plus 0.46. I'll let you calculate that. Theta 3, I guess, is 3 pi by 4. Theta 4 is about 5 pi by 4. 7 pi by 4. There we go. Sorry about that. Okay. Let's see if we can zoom out and keep the focus. Two similar equations, totally different approach depending on if there's a product or a sum. Make sure we understand. Oh, right. And as promised, the identity for the secant of theta squared. So I guess the hint is, oh, there's a square in it, which makes me think about the Pythagorean identity. So I know that the sine of theta squared plus the cosine of theta squared is equal to 1. If I wanted to build a secant ratio, I would be looking for a reciprocal of a cosine of theta. So instead of reciprocating both sides, because reciprocation isn't distributive across sums, take this identity that you've proven to be true and divide both sides by the cosine of theta squared. And you will build that the tangent of theta squared plus 1 is equal to the secant of theta squared. Okay, that is probably going to be, in hindsight, a much better approach to this question, because then I can jump from here all the way down to there. And I see, after a little bit of experimentation, I see a quick way of getting an equation with one ratio. This does go against some people's identity approach, though, of always trying to write things in terms of sines and cosines. That is a piece of advice that sometimes works for proving trig identities. It is not a rule that you should always do that. This equation is an example of a case where you wouldn't want to do that. Okay. Make sure you're clear on whether you are in a factored form or not. and make sure that you try it out.